Hey there, and welcome back. Last week, I shared a list of 11 must-have tools to improve your 3D printing workflow. By the way, if you haven't already seen that video, you can do so here. Just please make sure to open that video in a new tab because the YouTube algorithm will bend me over its knee like a misbehaved toddler in the 1930s if you stop watching this video so early on. Okay, thanks. See you in approximately 15 minutes. For the rest of you, I think a week is more than long enough to wait, so let's just dive right in, shall we? A lot of the tools I shared last week were geared towards making it faster and easier to diagnose and repair problems with your 3D printer when they inevitably come up. And I can think of no one tool that is unhelpful for unstucking your FDM 3D printer than a set of acupuncture needles. In a perfect world, your 3D printer would never get clogged. And even if it did, unclogging it would be as easy as pulling the filament out of the top of the extruder. But we don't live in a perfect world. We live in a world where Bran Stark became the prince that was promised on Game of Thrones, and the YouTube app still doesn't play in the background unless you pay for it. Fortunately, we can make our lives a little bit easier by keeping a set of acupuncture needles on hand. Now, I personally keep only the 0.4 millimeter ones, but you could buy different sizes too for your different nozzles. Anytime you get a clog, simply shove one of these little buggers up the business end of your extruder and voila, you're back to printing stuff that you probably don't need, but definitely want. Remember how I said that we don't live in a perfect world? Well, sometimes we live in a downright f***ed up world. A world where even shoving a sharp acupuncture needle up your printer's urethra doesn't shock it into compliance. In those cases, what you need is a nice, thick rod. I'm talking, of course, about a steel rod. I originally discovered this tool because it came with my GE-Tech A10M, a printer that clogged so much I thought I was in Holland. Basically, this tool is used for those instances where a clog is just so bad or so big that you can't free it up by pushing it back up the hot end. Instead, you use this tool to push the filament through the other side, giving it more force than a piece of filament can, and also allowing you to heat the hot end up so high that you can burn away the clog. I can't tell you how many times this tool has actually saved me back when I had a Bowden tube setup, especially when I was using inferior filament. Now, just make sure that if you're going to use this tool, you avoid grinding your extruder gears against it by first disassembling your extruder. You do not want to strip those Bontech gears because they are expensive. This next one is obvious and probably came with your 3D printer, but I still want this video to be as comprehensive as possible, so feel free to skip this one using the chapters below. Whether or not you have a flexible and removable print surface, you're still going to want at least one scraper tool, otherwise known as a putty knife, for clearing your print surface. Sure. Most of us can remove prints by removing and flexing the bed, but generally you'll still have things like priming lines or skirts that will stick to the bed after you remove the print. Not to mention the occasional hard to remove print that just doesn't want to come off. And I see you, glass bed folks, there's no shame in it. Now, removing these bits from the print surface with a scraper, metal in the case of a glass bed, or plastic in the case of a PEI textured sheet, well, it keeps you from getting the surface all oily with your sweaty meat sticks, ensuring that your future prints stick better with less prep needed. In my 3D printed tools video, I mentioned that you can and should 3D print your own scraper from plastic to protect your bed when removing prints. So if you haven't seen that video, well, check it out in a new tab now. This next one, I admit, is not strictly speaking a tool, but rather a means of organizing the tools that you are now starting to accumulate thanks to last week's video. Whether it's a low profile mount for your enclosure or lac enclosure, a tool organizer that sits on your power supply or whatever, make sure that you print yourself a nice tool organizer that works for your workflow, including all the tools you regularly use. Now, I'll link to a few of my favorites in the description, including the ones that I've designed, modified, and mounted in my own print enclosure. By the way, a few of you have actually asked about my enclosure, which is a custom-made piece of carpentry that I had designed and made twice around my 3D printers. Now, I haven't talked about it because it's not something that you can actually buy, but rather something that you'd have to build. But let me know in the comments below if you'd still like me to talk about it and share all the different things that I've printed, designed, wired, customized, and generally created to improve my workflow and upgrade it and add all kinds of functionality to it. By the way, speaking of adding functionality to your 3D printed projects, I want to take a quick moment and give a huge thanks to today's sponsor, PCBWay. Whether you're just a casual maker like me, or a hardcore geek, or even an engineer or business person scaling up production, PCBWay is your one-stop shop for creating incredible products and projects. Yeah, you already have a 3D printer at home. I get that. But do you have a metal 3D printer, a CNC machine, a laser cutter, sheet metal fabrication, or the ability to create custom PCBs? Yeah, me neither. But they do. PCBWay can even help you turn your 3D printed designs into professional injection molds. Best of all, they offer incredibly low prices, from $5 for 10 PCBs, and they allow you to order low volumes, as little as one piece for other production methods. To check them out and experience their prompt service and high quality, visit the link in the description or visit PCBWay.com. All right, back to the video. Now, this next item on my list is, once again, not the type of thing that you'd traditionally call a tool, but it is no less a crucial element for successful 3D printing. It's epoxy glue. When I first got into 3D printing, people talked a lot about super glue, otherwise known as CA glue or cyanoacrylate. Now, maybe it's just me, but I literally never get good results from super glue. Never. In the best case scenario, it bonds to the surfaces, but leaves hideous white fog all over the plastic. In the worst case scenario, the part falls apart again, and the only things really bonded together are my fingers. If a bottle of superglue is opened within 1 meter of Jonathan Levy, it will invariably end up on his hands. But fortunately, in the meantime, there are actually much better ways that you can bond your 3D prints together, ranging from rubber cement or E6000, if you need a little bit of give and eventual removability, to specialized epoxies when you need a permanent bond. Now, you can use any old two-part epoxy such as JB Weld for this, but personally, I've been using the specialized version of 3D Gloop, which is available for PLA, PETG, and ABS. Now, this stuff is so strong that they've done crazy demos at different trade shows, and my experience has been pretty much the same. 3D Gloop didn't sponsor this video, by the way, but hopefully someone from their team does see it because I've really been enjoying the product and I'd love to talk about it more. All right, let's now move on to, once again, talking trash. From my 50 plus things you didn't know you could 3D print, you all know that I love me a good 3D printed trash can and that I love to 3D print customized waste receptacles for all sorts of different needs. So why would my 3D printing workspace be any different? After all, as I'm sure you all know, 3D printers create a lot of small little bits of waste ranging from failed prints to skirts, supports, and of course, the dreaded purge lines that you find everywhere. These bits of plastic have become so pernicious in my house that I recently spent an exorbitant, embarrassingly high amount of money on a fancy robot which mops and vacuums and then empties itself and then cleans the mop and then empties the water and does all that. And then I set it to clean my house multiple times per day. But for larger pieces, the trash bin will go a really long way towards keeping that stuff off the ground. Personally, I use this slide-out trash bin designed for the LAC enclosure, and I have designed and printed this string wrangler attachment for the front to make it easy to stick stuff in there without it popping back out. I love that it slides in and out quickly and easily so I can empty it regularly, and I recommend that you check it out and print one for yourself. Up next, let's talk about calipers. Now, I imagine that many of you haven't yet experienced the joy of designing your own parts for 3D printing, but even if you don't design your own parts, these calipers definitely come in handy for measuring things that you want to scale a design up or down for. They're also great for calibrating your printer using a calibration cube. But of course, the main reason why you want a good set of calipers is for designing parts to suit your different needs in your own life. And honestly, if you aren't already designing your very own parts, well, I highly recommend it, even if it means using a basic kids' design tool like Tinkercad. When taking measurements for something that you are designing around, you really need to be as accurate as possible. And calipers make it dead simple to get highly accurate measurements, making them an absolutely indispensable tool. Now, personally, I have bought the cheapy ones in the past that broke after a week or so, so I'll actually link to my high-quality metal set that I found on AliExpress of all places in the description below. In part one of this video, I shared that I often use a torch lighter for targeted heating and reshaping of prints. But what about when something is really off or really warped and you would rather try to reshape it and finagle it rather than reprinting it altogether? Enter the heat gun, or at least a cheapy hairdryer that gets really, really hot. The list of uses for this are pretty much endless, including reshaping and reworking prints, removing strings, softening materials so that you can insert things like magnets, and so on. And, well, I guess that's really the end of the list of uses. I really thought there would be more uses for this one. But nonetheless, this is a pretty essential tool. I've used a cheapy hairdryer for quite some time, but I recently decided to spoil myself and ordered a heat gun in anticipation of my Voron project, though I imagine for most of the heating for that project, I'm going to instead use... What? A soldering iron? What does that have to do with 3D printing, you might ask? Well, first of all, you can use it to solder electrical components into your prints or projects to make them more functional, ranging from LEDs to switches to fans or even custom circuit boards from PCBWay. But what makes a soldering iron an essential tool for 3D printing is actually the fact that it can help you heat things up for inserting into your print. Now, this typically means heat set inserts, as I discussed in my video of must-have hardware to level up your 3D prints, but it also can mean magnets, bolts, or any other metal component that you need to reinforce your print in some way. Now, I recommend getting a decent adjustable temperature soldering iron, even if it's on AliExpress, because it's worth a few bucks more. All right, are you ready for a surprising one that no one else on YouTube is gonna tell you about? You see, because I own one of those overpriced Cricut vinyl cutting machines, I keep around these handy little picks that are designed for weeding stickers and stuff like that. But I've also discovered that these are really helpful for cleaning up very detailed prints when your supports are being stubborn. Now, what I like about them is that they have an extremely sharp edge, which also means you really need to watch out for your fingers. But that sharp edge allows me to get into very tiny nooks and crannies to remove supports. No, this tool isn't completely necessary, but it's come in handy quite a few times. Here's another one that you can probably get away with, but one that really comes in handy. A lot. I recently upgraded from those terrible dollar store glue guns with a short cable that blow up in your hand to a battery operated one that actually operates on a Makita 18 volt battery, and it's been a game changer. Not only can I now hot glue comfortably wherever my project takes me, such as the top of my print enclosure, but more importantly, I can control the temperature all the way up to 220 degrees Celsius. Now, this means that I can work with much, much higher quality hot glue, such as this epic Gorilla brand stuff, which not only dries much slower at 45 seconds, but also gives you a much, much stronger bond. Now, I used to think that hot glue was all garbage and was really not a good choice for any project. Now, I know that I was just using garbage hot glue. Now, I don't always hot glue my prints unless I specifically want to be able to peel them apart later without damaging the part in a way that super glue or epoxy would. But one thing I definitely do use this for is something that I saw on Reddit: saving prints that are threatening to detach from the print surface. Yes, You can literally use hot glue on the edges or lifting corners, shove it under there with a scraper, and save that 25-hour print from turning into a spaghetti monster. Try it and thank me later. All right, gang, somehow this video has also gone past 20 minutes, so we're coming to the end of the list. And while this next and last one is definitely not a must-have in the same way a deburring tool is, it will definitely improve your workflow and make tinkering on your projects much more comfortable, quick, and convenient. I'm talking about this nifty electric pen screwdriver. It's pretty basic with just a forward, back, and an LED light, and it somehow locks up the motor so that you can further tighten or loosen screws manually at the beginning or end. Now, this tool is useful because it will save you a lot of time and hand fatigue in between the beginning and end of a screw. And when you have a project that has hundreds and hundreds of screws, like my upcoming Voron build, make sure you're subscribed below, well, that can really add up. Yes, you can use a proper electric screwdriver or impact driver, but you have a lot less finesse and control. Plus, your electric screwdriver may or may not have a torque setting delicate enough to work on 3D printed projects. Honestly, for 30 or 40 bucks, you can get a knockoff version of the Xiaomi Wow Stick that works just fine, and it comes with every single bit that you could ever imagine. Plus, I designed this awesome Gridfinity bin to store it nice and neatly. Now, that brings us to the end of part two of this series, and I hope I've exposed you to some tools that will improve your workflow and make 3D printing just that much more enjoyable for you. If so, please make sure to leave a like and smash that subscribe button, and consider either using my affiliate links in the description below or sending me a tip using the thanks button. If not, no worries. I just appreciate you guys watching these videos and giving me a reason to talk about 3D printing. Thanks as always for watching, and until next time, happy 3D printing.